Good morning. Welcome to another Sunday here at the Lawson Road Church of Christ online. We are so glad to have you joining us. Today is Palm Sunday. It's a significant day in the Christian calendar. I don't know if you've ever really thought about it, that the church has its own calendar. Sure, it still uses January, February, March, etc. But from whether it be Christmas, Easter, Palm Sunday, some of these significant events. Pentecost is going to be coming up, 50 days after Easter. And there's a rhythm of significant events that take place, not just historical events, but spiritual events that take place throughout the year. Every year I think I tell people that I love this Sunday because although there's still discussion or confusion about exactly the exact day or base that Jesus entered Jerusalem or the exact day of his crucifixion, we have a pretty good approximation of it, and I think the Orthodox Church and the Western Church have two different dates, and the Jews might have a third date for their Passover, but they're all sort of around the same time and based on different calculations over the last 2,000 years. All of that aside, we know that on a Sunday, Jesus rode a donkey into Jerusalem. And then the Gospels give us a very detailed account of what happens throughout the rest of the week as he goes into the temple, as he has the Last Supper meal, as he washes the disciples' feet, as he goes ultimately on trial, as he's crucified, and then next Sunday, as he's resurrected. So we have these events, and you can track it throughout the week, and you can pause at any moment and say, what was Jesus doing on this day? And you can go and look it up, whether you do a Google search or read your Bible. Either way, you'll find the answer to what Jesus was doing. And so we can kind of track this week. A lot of people call it Holy Week. Because it's so close to Jesus' death, the last week of his life, and because we have so much information about it. So today is a special day, whether you've celebrated it very much before or not. And we're not going to make a big deal of it throughout our service. Our songs are kind of looking towards Easter, but we do celebrate Jesus as King. Even though he was rejected as a king, ultimately by Jerusalem on this day, we recognize that is the correct title to give him, that he is the King of Kings. And so we celebrate that, amongst other things, today. I hope that today's service is one that's encouraging to you, and that you are brought closer in your relationship with God through something that is said or read or prayed or sung today. I just want to, before we go into worship, I want to say thank you to everybody that came out yesterday for the work day we had at the church building. And we're getting ready for Easter, and so appreciate everybody's work. We got done, I think, all of the big items we wanted to do. And along those same lines, a reminder that we are meeting here at the church building for Easter next Sunday, and we'd love to have you. We would love for you to invite people. Now, here's what I would like you to do, is please invite people, whether you invite them to the building or you invite them to our online worship service. A lot of people are looking for ways to learn about Jesus, to do something spiritual on Easter. And so please get the word out, share our Facebook page, share our YouTube channel, When we're ready, send the invitation. Today is our last sermon in the Buddy Bench series. Next week we'll start a new series, so your friends or family are not going to be left behind in a series. We'll start a new series, and so it's a great time to invite people to join us, to get to know Lawson Road, but also to get to know Jesus in a new way if they haven't before. As we go into worship today, we're going to play a song. Please take a moment, give us a thumbs up, help people find us online by doing that, and grab your communion supplies if you haven't already, and grab your coffee. You may need that. I'm not saying it's going to be a boring service, but coffee always helps. And you're at home, so you can do that. And we will worship God together in just a moment.
Everybody falls sometimes. You gotta find the strength to rise from the ashes and make a new beginning. Anyone can feel the ache. You think it's more than you can take, but you're stronger, stronger than you know. Don't give up now. The sun will soon be shining. You gotta face the clouds to find the silver lining. I've seen dreams that move the mountains. Silent prayers get answered, broken hearts become brand new, and that's what faith can do. It doesn't matter what you've heard, impossible is not a word, it's just a reason for someone not to try, and everyone is scared to death. When they decide to take that step out on the water, it'll be alright. Life is so much more than what your eyes are seeing. You will find your way if you keep believing. I've seen dreams that move the mountains. Hope that doesn't ever end. Even when the sky is falling, I've seen miracles just happen. Silent prayers get answered. Broken hearts become brand new. And that's what faith can do. Overcome the odds when you don't stand a chance. But when the world says that you can't, it'll tell you that you can't. Just happen. Silent prayers get answered. Broken hearts become brand new. And that's what faith can do. That's what faith can do. Even if you fall sometimes, you will find the strength to rise.
Yes, thank you again for being with us for our worship service today. Always good to have you to join us. A couple announcements before we open with a word of prayer. Remember, our Walk for Water is June the 12th. That's a Sunday. We'll hold it at our building. A couple of things you can do for us right away. The church sent out an email this past week. There is a link on there to be able to go right to the Healing Hands website and to register for our event. That is very important. Please get yourself registered for the event. Additionally, if there is something you'd like to do and help serve that day, please call the church office. We'll be glad to get you enrolled. There's a list of items there that we can sign you up for and engage in the work. Most importantly, please register and, of course, join us on that day as well. Secondly, there's an important date coming up for us. April the 24th has been designated as Compassion Sunday. Now, what does that mean? As you remember, for our church budget, we use the collections for 50 Sundays of the year to handle all of our operational needs. In the fall, the 51st Sunday is designated as Mission Sunday. Now, that day, we collect all of our funds to support all of our mission works. In the spring, April 24th this year, we're going to have Compassion Sunday. Compassion Sunday will use all the contribution from that particular day to support the following works. We're going to use that money to support Camp Hunt, local agencies to support the needs in our community, and of course, a part of it is also going to be used for disaster relief efforts to help those who have disasters that strike homes in our nation. So please, if you can that day, not only make your regular contribution, but give a little extra, it'll help support the needs of others in our nation and around the world. Let us bow with a word of opening prayer. Thank you, dear Lord, again for our time to gather this day. You have been so good to us. You have granted us so many things in our life's walk. We are grateful. We ask now, please, as we come before you in our time of worship, that our thoughts are centered on you, that your spirit strengthens our spirits, that we are renewed and refreshed by our presence with you. As always, we are grateful for Jesus, our Redeemer, thankful that he came, died, rose, is at your throne, interceding for us, always. Yes, Lord, we are thankful that we know what it means to not only be your children, but to be your servants of your Son and his kingdom. Help us to continue our journey in a good way. Season our speech, guide our thoughts. Let our purpose and intentions always be mindful of the calling that you've presented for each of us. And by your design, dear Father, may we continue to do the work according to your will always. So good, Almighty Father, to come before you in our worship. Please be with us now. It's in Jesus' name we humbly pray. Amen.
You were the Word at the beginning, one with God the Lord Most High. Your hidden glory in creation now revealed in you our Christ. What a beautiful name it is, what a beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus Christ my King. What a beautiful name it is, nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus. You didn't want heaven without us, so Jesus, you brought heaven down. My sin was great, your love was greater. What could separate us now? What a wonderful name it is, what a wonderful name it is, the name of Jesus Christ my King. What a wonderful name it is, nothing compares to this. What a wonderful name it is, the name of Jesus. Death could not hold you, the veil tore before you. You silenced the boast of sin and grave. The heavens are roaring the praise of your glory, for you are raised to life again. You have no rival, you have no equal, now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is the kingdom. Yours is the glory. Yours is the name above all names. What a powerful name it is. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is. Nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus.
Hi, good morning, church. I hope everyone has had a good start to their week. We reached a part of our worship, which is the scripture reading. This morning, I'll be reading from Psalms chapter 118, verses 1 through 4, and then I'll jump down to verse 19 and finish up at verse 29. Again, that's Psalms 118, 1 through 4, and then verses 19 through 29. The Bible reads, "Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Let Israel say, his love endures forever. Let the house of Aaron say, his love endures forever. Let those who fear the Lord say, his love endures forever." Now to verse 19. "Open for me the gates of the righteous. I will enter and give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord, through which the righteous may enter. I will give you thanks, for you answered me. You have become my salvation. The stone the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. The Lord has done this, and it is marvelous in our eyes. The Lord has done it this very day. Let us rejoice today and be glad. Lord, save us. Lord, grant us success. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. From the house of the Lord, we bless you. The Lord is God, and he has made his light shine on us. With bows in hand, join in the festive procession up to the horns of the altar. You are my God, and I will praise you. You are my God, and I will exalt you. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever." Pray everyone have a blessed day.
Oh, worship the King, all glorious above, and gratefully sing his wonderful love. Our shield and defender, the Ancient of Days, pavilioned in splendor and girded with praise. Thy bountiful care, what tongue can recite? It breathes in the air, it shines in the light. It streams from the hills, it descends to the plain, and sweetly distills in the dew and the rain. Frail children of dust, and feeble as frail, in thee do we trust, nor find thee to fail. Thy mercies, how tender, how firm to the end. Our Maker, Defender, Redeemer, and Friend. Oh, tell of his might, oh, sing of his grace, whose robe is the light, whose canopy space. His chariots of wrath, the deep thunder clouds form, and dark is his path on the wings of the storm. Hosanna, Hosanna, forever we'll worship the King. Hosanna, Hosanna, forever we'll worship the King. Oh, measureless might, incomparable love, the angels delight to sing from above. Let all of creation delight in your ways, with deep adoration all sing to your praise. Hosanna, Hosanna, forever we'll worship the King. Hosanna, Hosanna, forever we'll worship the King. Hosanna, Hosanna, forever we'll worship the King. Hosanna, Hosanna, forever we'll worship the King.
As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethphage on the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and at once you will find a donkey tied there with her colt by her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, say that the Lord needs them, and he will send them right away." This took place to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet. "Say to daughter Zion, see, your king comes to you, gentle and riding on a donkey, and on a colt, the foal of a donkey." The disciples went and did as Jesus had instructed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and placed their cloaks on them for Jesus to sit on. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, while others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of him and those that followed shouted, "Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord! Hosanna in the highest heaven!"
Today we come to our final conversation on the Buddy Bench. It's been a long series and we've covered a lot of women in Scripture, but we certainly haven't covered all of them. We could keep going into Acts and look at more, but we're going to wrap it up today. We're actually not having a conversation with the woman sitting on the bench. I want to spend some time today telling you about her. If you remember our very first sermon in this series, you probably don't, but I described the buddy bench as a seat in the playground where if you see someone sitting alone, you're supposed to go over and talk to them or invite them to come and play with you. Now, I don't know what your school was like, but despite the best efforts of all the administrators and staff and parents and responsible adults, in my small Christian school, there was always at least one kid, maybe two or three, that my friends would never sit with. We wouldn't want to be seen sitting with that person. Perhaps they smelled funny or, you know, I don't know, dressed unusually, or sometimes there were stories that somebody had seen them do this or do that, or they said something funny or strange. And so we just kind of stayed away from them. And so maybe your school was like that. Maybe you were the person people stayed away from. And so I think that dynamic exists in many, many different settings. Throughout church history, Mary Magdalene has been that woman. Mary Magdalene has been the woman that everyone whispers about. There was something strange about her. In fact, in Luke chapter 8 and verse 2, we're told there that she had seven demons in her. That's all we're told. We don't know what they did to her, but she had seven. But you've got to imagine that having seven demons in you would make you strange in some way. That's different from most people. Well, about the year 600. Well, you know, so after Jesus, we've moved forward in history 600 years. Pope Gregory the Great, he made the not-so-great connection that Mary's seven demons signified the seven deadly sins. Those deadly sins are completely manufactured or invented by the church of the day. They're certainly not laid out that way in Scripture. But really, Pope Gregory, beyond making this connection of the number, he seems to have confused a couple of different events in the Bible. And I've put up here on the screen, you can see this table. First of all, in Luke chapter 7, we find the story we talked about last week, in fact, where a nameless woman washes Jesus' feet with her tears, dries them with her hair, and anoints them with oil. Now, in the next chapter, so very close to it, we're then introduced to Mary Magdalene. But there's no indication that she's appeared in the gospel previously. In fact, it seems that she's being introduced in chapter 8, rather than somebody who was already there in chapter 7. Then, over in John chapter 12, this is just before Jesus' death. In fact, on the Saturday before, really yesterday in our time frame, the Saturday before Palm Sunday, there's another meal that is given in Bethany, the town of Bethany outside Jerusalem. It's given in Jesus' honor at the home of Lazarus, Mary, and Martha, a brother and sisters. And at this meal, Mary, who's known to everyone, she's Mary of Bethany, she's the sister of Lazarus and Martha, she takes perfume, she pours it on Jesus' feet, and wipes it with her hair. So there's a couple of similarities between Mary of Bethany and the nameless woman in Luke chapter 7, who is described as a sinner, a sinful person. Now, both stories involve feet, perfume, and hair, but they're in different places, they're at different times, and the Mary in John 12 is clearly identified as not Mary Magdalene. And so you can see at the bottom of the screen here, this kind of logic that resulted in Mary Magdalene being labeled a prostitute. There's a sinful woman, there's feet, there's perfume, there's hair. Hey, there's Mary Magdalene. Oh, and Mary of Bethany. And so if we put them all in a blender, we sort of mix it up, out pops a sinful woman named Mary, who must be Mary of Magdalene, with her seven demons, which seven demons must make you make her sin sexual in nature, and the worst type of sexual sin is prostitution. Therefore, Mary Magdalene must be a prostitute. Yes, that logic's hard to follow, isn't it? Never mind the fact that most demons in the Gospels seem to negatively impact a person's physical and mental health, not lead them into a lifestyle of sin. But that's not the only rumor going around the playground of history about Mary Magdalene. There's one early, we'll call it gospel, a Gnostic writing by a sort of a heretical branch of Christianity, of the early church, that went off into some strange things. And they quite a bit of their writings have been preserved. And so there's this one book that they wrote, and It was rejected by the church, but it claimed that Mary Magdalene married Jesus. This idea was picked up by the author Dan Brown and became both a best-selling book and a movie that you might have heard of called The Da Vinci Code. The idea being that the church had hidden the fact that Jesus, over the centuries, has hidden the fact that Jesus was married and even had children because they wanted to keep the church male dominated. That was the claim by the Da Vinci Code. Finally, another rumor going around is not that they were married, but in the 1970s musical Jesus Christ Superstar, Mary Magdalene there falls in love with Jesus and sings one of the hit songs of the show, "I Don't Know How to Love Him." And so, as often happens in the playground, no one actually takes the time to get to know the real Mary. And they stay away from her because of all these rumors. Something must be wrong with her. There must be some measure of truth. Where there's smoke, there's fire, right? As we see Mary sitting over there on our buddy bench this morning, I want us to consider four things that we can know about her. Not rumors, but things that Scripture actually tells us. The first one, and the first two we talked about last week and won't spend a lot of time on today. But the first one is that following Jesus, after Jesus removed the demons from her, Mary became a disciple of Jesus. She literally followed Jesus as he traveled and walked around Galilee. The second thing that we know about her is that Mary was a financial patron of Jesus and the disciples. She had enough wealth to be able to contribute, along with other women, to Jesus so that he would have the means to support himself, to give charity to people, whatever their needs were. I think it's significant to point out here that we don't know the age of Mary Magdalene. If we were to go back through art over the centuries, Christian art, we would see that she's often portrayed provocatively, sexually, certainly as a younger person, but she may well have been an older woman, perhaps a widow that had her husband's wealth that she was able to then use to support Jesus and his disciples. And perhaps the respect that we'll see for her later may well be as a consequence of her age and her wisdom that she demonstrated in her time with the disciples. That's a guess, but she had accumulated the wealth somehow, and probably not from, certainly not from prostitution, probably not from her own business, but from marriage or from her family, inheritance, dowry sort of thing, would be where she would have access to money. So they're the two things. The first two, as I say, we mostly talked about those last week. She was a disciple, a follower of Jesus, and that she was a patron, a financial benefactor of Jesus. The third thing is that Mary was one of the female leaders among Jesus' disciples. We know this because she's mentioned by name in every gospel, in each of the gospels, and is often the first woman mentioned in a list of women. So, for instance, in Matthew 28 and verse 1, there we see her referred to as Mary Magdalene and the other Mary. So how would you like to be the other Mary, right? Mary Magdalene clearly was more well known, I suppose, within that the circle of people who were going to be reading that gospel. So she seems to be a leader because of the way that she is written about. And then the a fourth thing is that she was a key eyewitness of Jesus' death. Not only of his death, but also of his burial and his resurrection. And so I'm putting up this slide. I know the writing's fairly small there, but hopefully you can see it. How in each gospel, Mary is seen as being present at the death and somewhere in there, death, burial, empty tomb, and resurrection. But she was a witness to his crucifixion. We're told that she was there at the cross. We are told that she was a witness to his burial, that she, and along with the other women, paid attention to where Nicodemus and Joseph laid, which tomb it was that they laid his body. She was a witness. Matthew 28 there tells us how she was a witness to the earthquake and the angel telling her that Jesus was risen, the earthquake that rolled the stone away. She was a witness to the resurrected Jesus himself as she had a conversation with him according to the Gospel of John. Mary was a witness. I think it's significant here to think not only was she a witness in a verbal sense, but the stories of the Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection. The apostles aren't there. Matthew wasn't there. It doesn't seem that Mark was there. Luke is certainly not there. He comes along much later in Acts. And John was possibly there at the cross. But Mary was there at all of them. And so there are things that are written in the Gospels that probably she had to tell the authors of the Gospels what happened because they weren't there. And that really brings us to the last point about her, that she is she functions as an apostle to the apostles. Let me just explain that. The word apostle means messenger. And so Mary, having witnessed the resurrection of Jesus, she is now the first messenger or apostle of the gospel, the good news, not only that Jesus died, but that he is alive, that he defeated death. And so she runs to tell the apostles. And when she does that, she explains to them what Jesus has told her and that they're to go to Galilee and to meet him up there. Today is Palm Sunday. We heard earlier the reading of Jesus' entrance into Jerusalem as the humble king. The crowds that were there on that day, on that Palm Sunday, didn't know what to do with a humble king. And just a few days later, they're shouting, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" The disciples that were there with Jesus at the Last Supper didn't know what to do with a Messiah who was crucified. They gathered in an upper room, fearful of the Jewish leaders. But Mary and the women with her, they'd received, we're told, Luke tells us that, Luke 8 tells us that they had received deliverance from demons, they had received healing by Jesus, and her dedication to Jesus extended beyond Palm Sunday. Her commitment to follow extended beyond the Garden of Gethsemane. It carried her to the foot of the cross. It carried her to the tomb as he's laid in it. It brings her back on the Sunday morning to finish the preparations of his body and the burial of his body. It brings her back, even when she discovers the empty tomb, she comes back to it again after telling the disciples and stands there weeping outside the tomb by herself. Her commitment to Jesus, her desperation to find his body, her desire to, her determination to honor him, to have him buried respectfully, is really strong. Her faith that he is the Messiah, he is someone whose message and teaching is genuine, who has transformed her life, is exemplary for all of us. And perhaps it's because of all of this, this commitment that she demonstrates, this love that is that still is overflowing her heart and the grief that is expressed. Perhaps it's for these reasons that God allowed her to be the first witness and messenger of the resurrection. This is a Mary that shouldn't be the subject of rumors in the playground of history. This is a Mary that we can use as an example of faithfulness. Having been delivered from the darkness and the pain of her demons, she followed Jesus. Followed him around Galilee. But she was more than just a groupie. She was a student. And Jesus allowed her to be a student. He allowed a woman to come and learn from him just as he allowed the men. Jesus accepted her financial support. It wasn't an insult to his masculinity to depend upon her generosity. In Luke chapter 24, verses 7 and 8, we're told that when the angels reminded the women of Jesus' statement that he must be, the Son of Man must be crucified and on the third day rise again, they remembered his words. They remembered his words because they'd been following him. They'd been paying attention. They'd heard him make that statement. And when the angel says it, they're like, aha, yes, that's what has happened. Now it makes sense. And so that was part of the message, that they hurried off to tell the apostles, not only to tell them that the tomb was empty and that they'd seen an angel and that the angel had said this, but to explain how it was that Jesus' teaching had been fulfilled on this Easter morning. Mary Magdalene is never described as a prophet, but she is certainly a messenger of God, a messenger of good news, carrying the greatest message the world has ever known, that Jesus is alive. And so on Palm Sunday, as we consider what happens before Jesus' death, I think we're challenged to consider our faith, to consider the determination or the depth of our faith. Is our commitment to Jesus best represented by the crowds that are shouting and singing and rejoicing and happy and having a wonderful time on the road into Jerusalem as Jesus rides on the donkey? But then the crowds that disappear on the Monday and only show up again at his trial? Or is our faith, our commitment to follow Jesus best represented by the apostles who said, we're going to stick with you, we're not going to let you down, we're close to you, we're going to sit around a table with you and have a meal, we're going to serve you? But then life got really dangerous, really difficult, they went and they hid? Or is our faith represented by Mary Magdalene, the woman who, because she'd been delivered from so much, she loved so much, and her love and her faith and her commitment carried her through the doubts, the questions that people had in the crowd on Sunday. It carried her through the fears that the apostles had in the garden on Thursday, and it carried her past the cross on Friday. It carried her to the resurrection, to the empty tomb on the Sunday, and it was there that her faith was rewarded as she received the gift of life, of witnessing the life, the new life that Jesus had, and the hope that comes with it. I believe that our faith, likewise, when it persists, when it endures, when it gets through those difficulties, that we see Jesus also, that he rewards us with hope of a new life, a better life that only he can give. Mary Magdalene, like so many of the women that we've seen throughout Scripture, is an example to us of faith.
Good morning, Lawson Road Church family, visitors, and friends. In our Lord's Supper today, we are looking at the Gospel of John, chapter 17. Just before Jesus went to the olive grove where he would be betrayed and arrested, he gave the disciples their final marching orders and offered up a prayer to God, his Father. It was one of the most beautiful and emotional prayers recorded in the Bible. In this prayer, Jesus prayed for himself in verses 1 through 6, because the time had come for his divinely appointed death on the cross, and he wanted to glorify his Father. He prayed for his disciples, verses 7 through 19, because their next few days were going to be filled with pain, disappointment, disillusion, and because they were facing the challenge of taking Jesus' message into an unreceptive, even dangerous world. He prayed for all of those who would be deliverers, believers, because of his work and the work of the disciples, verses 20 to 26. Because he wanted them to live in unity with the Father and the Son, as well as one another. In the Gospel of Luke, chapter 22, verses 39 through 46, records Jesus' prayer on the Mount of Olives. Verse 39, Jesus went out as usual to the Mount of Olives, and his disciples followed him. On reaching the place, he said to them, "Pray that you will not fall into temptation." He withdrew about a stone's throw beyond them, knelt down, and prayed, "Father, if you are willing, take this cup from me. Yet not my will, but yours be done." An angel from heaven appeared to him and strengthened him. And being in anguish, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat was like drops of blood falling to the ground. When he rose from prayer, he went back to the disciples and found them asleep, exhausted from sorrow. "Why are you sleeping?" he asked them. "Get up and pray so that you will not fall into temptation." Now this was the second time he had said to them to pray so that you will not fall into temptation. These same words apply to us today, just as it applied to the disciples then. The temptation to become timid when we should be sharing God's word. The temptation to become discouraged. The temptation to give up on serving him because it is too hard. the temptation to let the world influence us instead of us being an example to the world because it's easier. As we celebrate the Lord's Supper, let us remember Jesus' instructions, which are to pray so that we will not fall into temptation. I will now pray for both the bread and the cup. Then we will partake of the elements of the Lord's Supper together. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for the bread that symbolizes your body that was sacrificed on the cross as payment for our eternal salvation, a debt that you pay willingly for us. We also give thanks for the cup that symbolizes the blood that was spilled from your body, spilled for the payment of our sin debt. For this we are eternally grateful. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same manner, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." This is the celebration of the Lord's Supper.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound. Amazing love, now flowing down from hands and feet that were nailed to the tree. As grace flows down and covers me, amazing grace, how sweet the sound. Amazing love, now flowing down from hands and feet that were nailed to the tree. As grace flows down and covers me, and covers me, and covers me, and covers me, and covers me. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound. Amazing love, now flowing down from hands and feet that were nailed to the tree. As grace flows down and covers me, and covers me, and covers me, and covers me, and covers me. He covers me, covers me.
Please pray with me as we conclude our virtual worship service this morning. Dear Holy Father, we're grateful, Father, for the time that you've granted us to be able to virtually attend this worship service. We thank you for the things that make it possible, the electronics, the willingness of the volunteers to put it on. We hope, Father, that someday soon we won't be able to, we won't need to have this, that we'll all be gathered together at the church building. We thank you, Father, for your love, for your grace, for your patience with us, and the word you've brought to us this morning. Please, Father, help us to digest what was said to us and to work it into our daily lives, Father, so that we can be more like Jesus, be closer to you, and rekindle and maintain our relationship with you. We pray, Father, for those that are not with us, whether it be sickness or traveling. Please keep them safe and bring them back to us as soon as they get well. We pray, Father, that you'll be with us in the coming week, that you help us get stronger, that you'll be with us as we attempt to share the good word and your love for us with other people in our daily walk. Please, Father, keep us safe from all the dangers that we encounter each and every day. Help this pandemic to be over, Father, completely. We realize that may not be possible, but again, keep us safe from that. Help us to spread your word to others, to minister to their needs, so that we may bring glory to your name. Father, we ask that you touch the world's leaders in some way, that they may put an end to their differences and their pride and their greed, and that whatever makes them battle each other, Father. Please be with the people of the Ukraine who are suffering, those that have had to leave their homes and move to other countries. Stay with them, Father, and keep them with the hope that they may be able to return to their homes someday. Be with our children, Father. Keep them safe during this time of sickness, this season of sickness. And help them to not only learn from their education, but also help them to learn more about you. Be with those of our ministry leaders, and be with those that we support in the mission field. Keep them safe. Father, we're grateful again for this time we've had to be with you and continue to be with us. We pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you for being with us, and we hope that you'll join us soon at the church building. Have a blessed week.
Thank you for sticking around for one more thing. I'm so glad you did. I forgot to say at the very beginning, as I talked about our plans for Easter, if you are able to come to the church building, or if you know somebody who has children, then next Sunday for Easter, we're going to have an Easter egg hunt, and it will immediately follow our worship service. Instead of Bible class, we're actually going to have no Bible class next week. We know a lot of people have family time and family meals that they're looking forward to. And so we will have extra time for fellowship. We'll have the children doing their Easter egg hunt. And then we will go home. We'll pick up Bible class again the following Sunday. I want to share with you a book that has really impacted my life. And it was actually an older book, and you're like, this library is supposed to be books written in the last 5 years. And so they came out with a new edition, and that was enough to allow it to sneak in. It's called The Cruciform Church, and it's written by Leonard Allen. And the subtitle is Becoming a Cross-Shaped People in a Secular World. And so the idea of a cruciform means cross-shaped, right? It's to do with a cross. And so how are we as a church, how are we as Christians shaped by the cross of Jesus? Not just in terms of, oh, because Jesus died, then we're forgiven and we go to heaven. But how does the cross really impact who we are as children of God? And so it talks, it's a really good book. And I just want to encourage you to read it if you get the opportunity. It'll be in the library. You can pick it up and come by and pick it up at any time. And one of the interesting things about this second edition is that each chapter has a sort of a response, is the word, by different well-known church leaders. And so you read the chapter, and then there's a reflection on it by a different author. And they're all by different authors, each reflection. And so that's something that's different and maybe helps to apply it and to think about it in a different light, or to compare your thoughts with the thoughts of the second author. So I think it's a good addition to what is already a powerful book that re-examines how the church exists in the world and interacts with the world around us. So The Cruciform Church, I highly, highly recommend it. I hope your week is a good one, that you are closer to God at the end of it, and that you are a witness to Him, for Him, to the people around you.
I want to be near the cross, near the cross. I want to be near the cross, the cross where Jesus died, where He died, the cross where I receive my sight. I want to be near the cross, and I want to hold His hands, hold His hands. I want to hold His nail-scarred hands, the hands that lifted me from bondage and set me completely free. I want to hold His hand, and I want to touch His side. I want to touch where they pierced His side, where blood and water flowed. Yes, it did, and there's no greater love that was ever shown. Said I want to touch His side. His name is Jesus. He
suffering Jesus.
Just one.